Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ in vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be loved by Rome, sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Good evening. Welcome to Walt's Mystery Babylon News Radio. My name's Tom Press, and tonight we're going to continue our reading and discussion of the book Romanism and the Reformation by Henry Grattan Guinness. And we'll continue backing up just a few paragraphs where we left off last Sunday on the program. This will be a two-hour program, 1 hour of reading, and then an hour of discussion. Beginning at the bottom of page 92, the last full paragraph, it says, "Observe the position of the man of sin. Notice the word," and then it gives it in Greek, and then the translation, sitteth, S-I-T-T-E-T-H. Notice the word sitteth, and connect it with, and then there's another Greek word, which I cannot read, but it is translated seat. All right, I'll start over. Observe the position of the man of sin. Notice the word sitteth, and connect with it a seat, a word which occurs three times in the New Testament. It's used twice with reference to the seats of the temple of those who sold doves, who turned the house of God into a house of merchandise and a den of thieves. And once again in the sentence, quote, "the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat," unquote. From this word in Greek that is translated seat comes the word cathedral. Okay? If you saw this word in Greek, you would see how from it they get the word cathedral. This is representative of the seat. Now remember, a cathedral in the Roman Catholic Church is a seat of the bishop, okay, the local bishop. His headquarters are in a cathedral. It is an official seat of the Roman Catholic Church, part of the Holy See, part of the government of the Roman Catholic Church. Remember, every cathedral is not just a church. It's a center of power. It's a center of political and religious power. It says, from the word, and it gives it in Greek, comes the word cathedral, the bishop's seat, unquote, and also the expression ex cathedra, which means when a bishop speaks authoritatively in relation to the Roman Catholic Church, he speaks from the cathedral or from the seat, and ex cathedra means from the seat, okay, from the cathedral. And it says, and when we say the Pope speaks ex cathedra or from his seat officially, there in that exalted cathedral position and claiming to represent God, the man of sin was to act and abide as the pretended vicar or the replacement of Christ. But instead, the real Antichrist, the real antagonist of Christ, undermining Christ's authority, abolishing Christ's laws, and oppressing Christ's people. Isn't that what the papacy does? And who else in the world, what other institution can you name that does these very same things? There's not a one in the whole world that pretends to be the vicar of Christ, the replacement of Christ, but is instead the antagonist of Christ. And we know he is the antagonist of Christ because he undermines Christ's authority by saying that he replaces Christ and he abolishes the laws of God, such as we discussed last time, the Sabbath law. The seventh day has now become Sunday, and oppressing his people. And what have we not learned about the oppression of God's people coming from the Roman Catholic Church? What other institution on the planet fulfills this prophecy? There isn't one. Now the author continues, he says, observe the words, quote, who opposeth, unquote. It is possible effectually to oppose another without being his avowed antagonist. In other words, a pretended friend. So the professions of the predicted power might be friendly, while his actions would be those of an opponent of the gospel of Christ. And that is indeed what the papacy is. It pretends to be a friend, just like Judas Iscariot, a Judas priest. The papacy, the Judas priest of the Bible, and is literally antagonistic and an opponent to the gospel of Christ. How can you say that you are for Christ when you say you replace Christ, and then when you prove it by changing his times and his laws? Again, there is no other candidate for Antichrist in the world, in history, and today, than the papacy itself. And I assert that this author and all the Protestant reformers were correct about the papacy, that he is, was, and always will be the Antichrist of the Bible. The seat of the papacy, no matter who is seated in it, is the Antichrist of his time, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist of his time. They all fulfill the role of Antichrist. Now he continues. We have said that the principles which were ultimately to produce the man of sin had already begun to operate in Paul's own day. Now, stop and think. If futurism is correct, and there's only one Antichrist to come, one man of sin, one son of perdition, and he comes in 7 years before Christ's return, how could that man of sin already be in operation in Paul's own day? Futurism is a lie. Paul knew the power that would eventually become the Antichrist, and it wasn't far off. He continues. His words are, quote, "the mystery of iniquity doth already work," unquote. And these principles would continue to work until the full development of the apostasy and its final destruction at the second advent of Christ. That is, throughout the entire 18 Christian centuries. So where's the futurism in that? This author, just like every Protestant reformer before him, said that the Antichrist was seated not long after Paul's ministry, and that it would continue until Christ came. Now, at the time of the writing of this book, that had been 18 centuries. Now it's been over 20 centuries. And Antichrist has been with us all along. He's still here, a very popular personage on television and the newspapers, saying we must have Sunday, we must have a new global government, we must have a new global religion, and we must have world peace. And he still speaks in Christ's name as though he were his vicar and his replacement. Nothing has changed except the knowledge of God's people today, completely ignorant of what all Protestants and all Christians before our generation knew. Deep down in the marrow of their bones, they knew who the Antichrist was, just as much as we know who Jesus Christ is. And no one could ever convince them otherwise. But we have been deceived in our generation. Now he continues, he says, the sphere of their operation, therefore, cannot be the Jewish temple, which was destroyed in the first century, but must needs be the professing Christian church. Now, this dispels all those out there who say the Antichrist will be a Jew, or that the Jews will rule the world in the millennium. This is not to be. The Bible in the book of Daniel describes four world empires from the time of Nebuchadnezzar during the Babylonian captivity until the coming of Christ. There were to be four and four only: the Babylonian, the Medo-Persian, the Greek, and the Roman. And the Roman Empire was in place before Christ was even born. There is not to be a fifth, but a restoration of one of the four preceding. This eliminates the possibility. The Bible virtually and practically and effectually and unmistakably abolishes any hope for a Jewish world government. So all those conspiracy theorists out there who blame everything on the Jews and that the Jews want to rule the world have simply been deceived, simply do not understand, nor do they believe what the Bible clearly teaches. And Henry Grattan Guinness confirms, he says, the sphere of their operation, the sphere of the operation of the man of sin, therefore, cannot be the Jewish temple, which was destroyed in the first century, and I will add, is still destroyed. For the entire Christian history, it has never been rebuilt, and it must needs be the professing Christian church. So the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist of the Bible, must come from the Christian church, the so-called Christian church. It's the Roman Catholic Church. Now, it says an important point in the prophecy is the existence in apostolic times of a certain restraining power, withholding, while it lasted, the manifestation of the man of sin. Paul, for good reasons, speaks of it in guarded language as, quote, he who letteth, unquote, or, quote, that which hinders, unquote. What it was, Paul knew, and the Thessalonians knew from him. Quote, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you, unquote. So clearly we have an indication that Paul knew from where the man of sin would come, where he would originate, knew that he would ascend to power as soon as the restrainer was moved out of the way, and we know that from history, that was the Caesars of the Roman Empire, and Constantine was the one who left his seat of power and authority in Rome and went to Constantinople and left his power and seat and authority, his diadem, his college of his Senate, which is now the College of Cardinals, left it all in the hands of the Bishop of Rome, who has now become the Pope. Paul was right. Only when he wrote his letter to the Thessalonians, he had to speak in rather clandestine terms, because had his epistle, had his letter fallen into Roman hands, he and all of his followers would have been hauled into Rome as seditious. So Paul used caution when he wrote his letter to the Thessalonians, talking about this man of sin, this son of perdition. But clearly, by the text of the scriptures, we know Paul used no caution when he was speaking face to face with them. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I told you? Paul knew who the man of sin would be, and so did the Thessalonians. And that word had to spread through all the Christian world, the true Christian world. And there would rise an apostasy, and it would center in Rome. And that man of sin would be the head of it. It calls itself Christian, but it is not Christian. That's the Roman Catholic Church. Now it says the early church, from who alone we can learn what Paul told them by word of mouth, but refrained from committing to writing, has left it on record that the apostle had told them that this hindering power, this restraining power, was the dominion of the Roman Caesars, that while they continued to reign at Rome, the development of the predicted power of evil, the man of sin, the son of perdition, was impossible. Hence, it would seem that Rome would be the seat of the man of sin. And it is. During the continuance of the Roman Empire, there was no opportunity for him to rise. He would only be manifested on its fall. While the Caesars reigned, he could not appear. But when they passed away, he would succeed them. Notice particularly that just as the expression, quote, he that letteth or he that restraineth, comprehends the line or succession of the Caesars, so the expression, quote, he that sitteth, unquote, may well comprehend an analogous line or succession of rulers. Both expressions refer to dynasties and not to individuals. We're talking about dynasties of the Caesars, one Caesar after another, occupying the seat and power and authority of the Roman Empire, and likewise the popes, in their successions, following the same pattern, existing as the man of sin, the son of perdition, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, the little horn who rose up after the Caesars ended. Okay? Clearly, fulfilled in history, indisputable proof that the one whom Paul spoke of is indeed the man that we call today the papacy. And every pope throughout history and every pope that will come in the future. There is but one man of sin. That office, that seat, that throne, that cathedral will always be occupied by the man of sin until Christ returns. That much we know from the scriptures, and that much we know from history. These expressions refer to dynasties and not to single individuals. It doesn't talk about single individual Caesars, nor does it talk about single individual Roman bishops. So there you have, the man of sin is an office, a succession, just like history reveals. Now, it says the distinctive names given by Paul to the great head of the apostasy are expressive of his character. They are, quote, the man of sin, quote, the son of perdition, unquote, and, quote, that wicked, or rather, the lawless one. First, it was to be to an extraordinary extent sinful itself, and the occasion of sin in others. Secondly, it would be like Judas and share his doom. And thirdly, it would set at defiance all laws, whether human or divine. It would be inspired by Satan, and on account of its evil character and actions, it would be doomed to destruction. It would eventually, quote, go to its own place, unquote. The bottomless pit from whence it emanated. Remember, the dragon gave him his seat and power and great authority? That's the papacy. He continues, he says, its doom was to fall in two stages. The Lord himself would consume it by the spirit of his mouth and destroy it by the brightness of his coming, or his advent in power and glory. There would be first a consumption, then a destruction. It would continue until the second coming of Christ. That's right, the papacy is going to continue until the second coming of Christ. A statement which, as you will observe, involves the Lord's return before the millennium. Since there can be no millennium under the reign of the man of sin, nor prior to his utter destruction. Let us now compare this portrait of the man of sin drawn by the Apostle Paul with the portrait of the self-exalted power foretold by Daniel, the prophet, who we studied last week. The comparison will demonstrate their identity. Number one, both are Roman. The self-exalting horn or head represented by Daniel is Roman. It belongs to the fourth or final or Roman Empire. So also does Paul's man of sin, for the imperial government seated at Rome needed to be removed in order to make way for its rise and dominion. It was to be the successor of the Caesars at Rome. They have the same geographical seat. Number two, they have the same chronological point of origin. Both arise on the fall of the old undivided Empire of Rome, and they have the same chronological termination. Daniel's little horn perishes at the coming of the Son of Man in glory, and Paul's man of sin is destroyed at the Epiphany. Number three, both exalt themselves against God. Daniel mentions the proud words of the blasphemous little horn, and Paul the audacious deeds of the man of sin, showing himself as divine. Is that not what the papacy does? Number four, both begin as small, inconspicuous powers and develop gradually to very great and influential ones. Number five, both claim to be teachers of man. Daniel's little horn was to have eyes as a bishop or overseer. The meaning of the word bishop itself is overseer. And that he was to have a mouth. That is, that he was to be a teacher. While Paul assigns to the man of sin ecclesiastical eminence, a proud position in the temple of God or Christian church. Number six, both are persecutors. Daniel described the little horn as a persecutor, wearing out the saints. And Paul speaks of the man of sin as, quote unquote, opposing, and calls him, quote, the lawless one, unquote. To sum up, the two have the same place, Rome, the same period, from the 6th century to the second coming of the Lord in glory, the same wicked character, the same lawlessness, the same self-exalting defiance of God, the same gradual growth from weakness to dominion, the same episcopal pretensions, the same persecuting character, and the same twofold doom. These resemblances are so important, so numerous, so comprehensive and exact as to prove beyond all question that the self-exalting, persecuting power predicted by Daniel and this man of sin foretold by Paul are one and the same power. Even Romanists admit this to be the case and call the power thus doubly predicted the Antichrist. Even the people in the Roman Catholic Church believe by these prophecies that we've just cited that they speak of none other than the Antichrist. The only thing that they deny is that the Pope fulfills those prophecies, which is just plain common sense ignorance, despite the spiritual blindness of the Roman Catholic Church. And what is most shocking and most appalling, that those in the world today who still use the name Protestant to describe themselves are just as ignorant as the Catholics who identify these prophecies as marking the Antichrist, but still can't see that it's the papacy. One can only wonder what darkness and what blindness has come over Protestantism that makes them, in their prophetic view, identical with Roman Catholics. And I'll tell you what it is. They taught futurism. One Antichrist at the end of time, 7-year period of time, a peace treaty with the Jews. And then he reneges on the peace treaty. And then everybody knows that's the Antichrist, when all the time it's been the papacy. You wouldn't be able to sell futurism to even one of the Protestant reformers. Yet it has become the orthodox teaching, the orthodox belief among those who call themselves Protestants today. And because they believe in a single individual, a future Antichrist, they now view the papacy not as the man of sin, not as the little horn of Daniel, not as the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist of the Bible, not as the persecutors of the saints, but as a man of God and a spiritual leader for the whole world. And they're uniting with him. Ecumenically, they are uniting with him spiritually. And they're committing spiritual suicide. Don't let them take you with them. We have to restore Protestantism in this country if there's ever a hope that the United States will be a godly nation. And if not the restoration of Protestantism in the United States, it will become a Roman Catholic dictatorship. It'll fulfill the prophecies that are predicted of it in the Bible. In Revelation chapter 13, the second beast, it causes the whole world to worship the first beast before it. Now, the author continues on page 98. He says, in the Douay Bible, that is the Roman Catholic Bible, in the Douay Bible with notes issued under Romish authority and bearing the signatures of Cardinals Wiseman and Manning, the, quote, man of sin, unquote, is interpreted as follows, quote, he sitteth in the temple of God, unquote, etc. By all these words is described to us the great Antichrist, according to the unquestionable authority and consent of the ancient fathers, unquote. Rome allows thus the little horn of Daniel and the man of sin of Paul foreshadow one and the same power, and admits that the power is to be the Antichrist. So far, then, for our examination of the prophecies of the Roman Antichrist, given some of them 1,000 and others 500 years before the actual appearance of the predicted power. Strange and incomprehensible must these prophecies have appeared, both to those who gave them and to those who received them. Little could they imagine the tremendous scale, both geographical and chronological, on which they were to be fulfilled. They understood clearly that an awful prophecy was to intervene an awful apostasy was to intervene between the early church and the advent of Christ. But how far it would extend and how long it would last, they knew not and could not know. A terrible enemy to God and to his church was to arise, strange as it might seem, in that church itself. And yet it was to have its seat in Rome, which was in their day the throne of the pagan persecutors of Christianity, the Caesars. How could these things be? Much was revealed, but much was left still utterly mysterious, and which time only could have interpreted. Turn now from the prophecy to the history, and let the latter interpret the former. We see what was predicted. Let us ask, what has happened? What are the historical facts? Remember that word, historical. What are the historical facts? Let me elaborate a little bit on this. If God makes a prophecy in the Bible, says certain things are going to happen in the future, where would you look to see that that thing happened? Where would you look? Certainly you would look in history, wouldn't you? You would keep your eyeballs peeled for the fulfillment of the words spoken in the prophecy. And they would eventually be written in history in order to prove the fulfillment of those prophecies. This is what the Protestant reformers were. They were historicists. They saw the fulfillment of the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist of the Bible, fulfilled in history, in the popes. They weren't looking for a future Antichrist. They weren't looking for one individual. They were looking for someone or something, a power that would come after the Caesars, the restrainer, left Rome. They had no idea how long it would continue, except that it would continue until Christ's return. Since they did not know how long Christ would return, they had no idea that it would last 2,000 years. But we know, and why should we be confused today? Why should we be futurists today when the prophecies were fulfilled in history regarding Antichrist? The history of the Christian church does not record a steady progress in the pathway of truth and holiness and uninterrupted spread of the kingdom of God on earth. On the contrary, it tells the story of a tremendous apostasy. Even in the first century, as we learn from the New Testament, they're set in a departure from the gospel and a return to certain forms of ritualism, as among the Galatians. In the second and third centuries, anti-Christian doctrine and anti-Christian practices, sacramentalism and sacerdotalism invaded the church and gradually climbed to a commanding position, which they never afterwards abandoned. In the fourth century, with the fall of paganism, began a worldly imperial Christianity, wholly unlike primitive apostolic Christianity, a sort of Christianized heathenism. And in the 5th and 6th century sprang up the papacy, in whose career the apostasy culminated later on. The mighty Caesars had fallen. Augustus, Domitian, Hadrian, Diocletian were gone. Even the Constantines and the Julians had passed away. The seat of sovereignty had been removed from Rome to Constantinople. Goths and Vandals had overthrown the Western Empire. The once mighty political structure lay shivered into broken fragments. The imperial government was slain by the Gothic sword. The Caesars were no more, and Rome was an actual desolation. Then slowly, on the ruins of the old imperial Rome, rose another power and another monarchy, a monarchy of loftier aspirations and more resistless might, claiming dominion not alone over the bodies, but even over the consciences and the souls of men. Dominion not only within the limits of the fallen empire, but throughout the entire world. Higher and higher rose the papacy, till in the Dark Ages, all of Christendom was subject to its sway. That's right, during the Dark Ages, which are known to be the Dark Ages because every man, woman, and child was subject to the darkness of the Roman papacy, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist. They were kept ignorant. They were kept illiterate. The Bible was not allowed to be read by the lay people. They simply got their Christianity from the priests of Rome. Transformed into angels of light, every one of those Roman Catholic priests deceived those people into believing that they had to serve the Roman Catholic Church to get to heaven. They had to confess their sins to the priests. Christ was surely mentioned, but nothing true about him was said. That's what made the Dark Ages so dark. There was no light, no truth about Christ. The Roman Catholic Church hid the truth and deceived all of Europe. That's the Antichrist. He continues, he says, quote, under the sacerdotal monarchy of St. Peter, unquote, says Cardinal Gibbon, quote, the nations began to resume the practice of seeking on the banks of the Tiber their kings, their laws, and the oracles of their fate, unquote. And this was a voluntary submission. As a kingdom, the papacy was not at that time in any position to enforce it. Not by military power, but by spiritual and religious pretensions did the Bishop of Rome attain supremacy in the church and in the world. It was by his lofty claim to be the vicegerent of Christ, by his assumption that he was as God on earth. It was by means of his episcopal position, you know, his seat, that he attained by degrees supreme power, not in the church only, but in the entire world. The growth of this power to these gigantic proportions was a most singular phenomenon. The Protestant reformer Tyndale, speaking of it, says this, quote, to see how the Holy Father came up, mark the example of the ivy. First it springeth up out of the earth, and then a while creepeth along by the ground, till it find a great tree. Then it joineth itself beneath unto the body of the tree, and creepeth up a little, fair and softly. At the beginning, while it is yet thin and small, the burden is not perceived. It seemeth glorious to garnish the tree in winter, but it holdeth fast withal, and ceaseth not to climb up till it be at the top, and even above all. And then it sendeth its branches along by the branches of the tree, and overgroweth all, and waxeth great, heavy, and thick. And it sucketh the moisture so sore out of the tree and its branches that it cloaketh and stifleth them. Sound familiar? You wonder why your church is so dry? Because that Roman ivy has sucked the sap right out of it. With futurism. And it says, then the foul stinking ivy waxeth mighty in the stump of the trunk of the tree and becometh a seat and a nest for all unclean birds and for blind owls which hawk in the dark and dare not come to the light. Quote, even so, the Bishop of Rome, now called Pope, at the beginning, crope along upon the earth, and every man trod on him. As soon as there came a Christian emperor, he joined himself to his feet and kissed him and crope up a little with begging now this privilege, now that. And thus with flattering and feigning and vain superstition under the name of Saint Peter, he crept up and fastened his roots in the heart of the emperor. And with his sword climbed above all his fellow bishops and brought them under his feet. And as he subdued them by the emperor's sword, even so, after they were sworn faithful, he by their means climbed up above the emperor and subdued him also and made him stoop unto his feet and kissed them. And thus the Pope, the father of all hypocrisies, hath with falsehood and guile perverted the order of the world and turned things upside down. Unquote. Quote, all the kings of the West revered the Pope as a god on the earth, unquote, said Pope Gregory II, and he spoke truly. Sismondi describes how King Pepin and the Franks received him as a divinity. His dogmas were regarded as oracles, his bulls and sentences as the voice of God. Quote, the people think of the Pope as one God that has power over all things in earth and in heaven. Unquote. Marcellus, addressing the Pope at the Lateran Council, said, quote, thou art another God on earth. Unquote. And, quote, our Lord God the Pope, unquote, was an often accepted title. These are facts, substantial facts of history, which can be proved by countless documents and which indeed no Romanist will deny. The people rendered and the Pope received worship, the worship due to God alone. At the coronation of Pope Innocent X, Cardinal Colonna, in his own name and that of the clergy of St. Peter's, addressed the following words to the Pope. Quote, kneeling on his knees, unquote, he said, quote, most holy and blessed Father, head of the church, ruler of the world, to whom the keys of the kingdom of heaven are committed, whom the angels in heaven revere, and the gates of hell fear, and all the world adores, we especially venerate, worship, and adore thee, unquote. What blasphemous exaltation is here? Have not Paul's words have been fulfilled? Has not this man of sin sitting in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God, or allow himself to be treated as divinity, nay, even proclaim to be so treated? He allowed himself to be styled, quote, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world, unquote, because he gave and sold indulgences for sin. He was even more merciful than Christ, for he left the souls in purgatory. And the Pope took them out. He could command even the angels of heaven and add saints to the celestial choir, raising dead men to form part of heaven's hierarchy as saints, and causing them henceforth to be worshipped by the church on earth. In all this, the Pope was as God upon the earth. It was his to speak and govern as God. It was the world's to bow down, to believe, and to obey. See him in his robes of more than kingly royalty, and with his crown of more than terrestrial dominion, not one, but three in one, a triple crown. The proud papal tiara of the papacy symbolizes power on earth, power in heaven, and power in hell. In all three, the Pope claims to rule. He is far above all kings. He is the vicegerent of God, the regent of the universe. He never rises from his pontifical throne by any person whomsoever, or rather to any person whomsoever, nor uncovers himself before mortal man. He does not even condescend to honor any human being by the least inclination of his head. His nuncios and legates take precedence of the ambassadors of all the crowned heads. Cardinals, the chief princes of the church, adore his holiness upon their bended knees, kissing his right hand and even his feet. At his coronation, they set him on a high altar of St. Peter's and adore him as the representative of deity. He is carried in lofty state on men's shoulders, beneath a canopy hung with fringe of gold. People, prelates, princes, and cardinals exalt and worship him with the most solemn ceremonies. He is the head of the universal church, arbiter of its rights and privileges. He wears the keys as the sign of his power to open the gates of heaven to all believers. He holds two swords as judging in things temporal and things spiritual. He is, quote, the sole and supreme judge of men, and can himself be judged by no man, unquote. He is the husband of the church, and as such wears a ring, indicating her perpetual betrothal to himself. Thousands upon thousands kneel before him. They struggle to get near his person. They stretch forth their hands to obtain his indulgences and crave his quasi-divine benediction, that, quote, smoke of smoke, unquote, as Luther called it. The deluded multitude rend the air with acclamations at his approach. In his possessions, all are gorgeous magnificence. Swiss guards and other attendants form his cortege in scarlet cloaks, embroidered with gold, with silver maces, and rich caparisons, silk housings, red velvets, purples, satins, laced with gold, long flowing robes sweeping the ground, some crimson, some black, some white, and caps adorned with precious stones and helmets glittering in the sun. His litter is lined with scarlet velvet, fringed with gold, and he himself is clothed in a white satin cassock with rochet, stole, and mosette, all of red velvet if it is winter, or of red satin if it is summer. At his adoration by the canons and clergy of St. Peter's, he is clothed in a white garment and seated on a throne, and thus attired, he, quote, presides in the temple of the Lord, unquote. Mark these words. He, quote, presides in the temple of the Lord, unquote. I took them from Picard's description of a Roman ceremonial, a Roman Catholic authority. It is the Romanists themselves who use this significant phrase of the papal pontiff. He presides in the temple of the Lord. Exalted to this position, he is incensed, and the cardinals at one at a time, in solemn, deliberate state and idolatrous submission, kiss his hand, his foot, and even his stomach. He's surrounded by cardinals, archbishops, bishops, abbots, priests, and princes. Enormous fans of peacock feathers are carried on either side of his chair, as used to be done by the pagan monarchs of older times. He directs the affairs of the greatest empire upon earth, governing by an almost infinite number of men whom he keeps constantly in subjection to himself and from whom he demands frequent periodical account. He distributes spiritual gifts and exalts to the highest preferments, not only on earth, but also in heaven. For is it not his to make bishops and archbishops, to canonize whom he will, and to decree their perpetual memorial and worship in the world? All power is delivered unto him. He forgives sins. He bestows grace. He cancels punishments, even in purgatory. He restores the lapsed. He excommunicates the rebellious. He can make that which is unlawful, lawful. He cannot err. His sentences are final. His utterances infallible. His decrees irreformable. Oh, dread dominion! Oh, dizzying height! Oh, blasphemous assumption! Oh, sublime satanic tyranny! Who is like unto thee, thou resuscitated Caesar, thou false Christ? Lord of the conscience, thou sittest there as a very deity, quasi-deus, as God. Thou sittest supreme, as thine own words are witness, quote, in the temple of the Lord, unquote. Look again at the confessional, where every priest sits as an image of the Pope, his master, with the sacred consciences of men and women beneath his feet as though he were a god. For mark, he searches the heart, the very secrets of the soul. He demands the discovery and confession of all sins. He makes himself master of all its thoughts and intents. He sits in that temple of the human conscience, which God claims solely for himself. Oh, awful position! And there he presumes to reign, to decide, to absolve from sin. Absolvo te, I absolve thee, is his word. The sinner regards him as holding the place of Jesus Christ. This Romish work is a witness that it is so. This is the Ursuline Manual. Here in the chapter for the directing of those who go to confession, and every papist does, are these words, quote, confessors should not be viewed in any other light than as holding the place of Jesus Christ, unquote, page 177. And again on page 182, quote, when you leave the confessional, do not disturb your mind by examining whether you have been confessed well or have forgotten any of your sins, but rest assured that if you have made your confession with sincerity and the other requisite dispositions, you are, according to the express decisions of the Council of Trent, fully absolved from every sin, unquote. Quote, who can forgive sins but God only, unquote. See how the man of sin sits in God's temple and robs God of his place and his prerogative? Look at this other book. It is the volume of the Laws and Constitutions of the Jesuits. Here on page 10, the Jesuit is taught that his superior, whoever he may be, must be recognized, reverenced, and submitted to with perfect and complete subjection of act and thought as occupying the place of Jesus Christ. Thus, the priest in the confessional and the superior in the Jesuit order and the bishop and the archbishop and cardinal all reflect the sacerdotal supremacy of the Pope, who sits there in God's very temple, the temple of the conscience and of the Christian Church, as a usurping God, a quasi-deus, a false god, as if God himself. But we must pass on from this point. The position assumed by the man of sin in the Church of God, and ask whether Romanism has fulfilled the other predictions of St. Paul as to, quote, lying wonders and signs or false miracles and the deceits of unrighteousness. Has she employed these as a means of gaining power, deluding her votaries that she might the more effectually enslave them? To exalt the priesthood, and especially its head, the papal high priest, Rome has spared nothing. She has trampled alike on the intellect and the consciences of mankind, and despised the eternal well-being of souls by inducing them to believe lies. The man of sin was to come with all power and signs and lying wonders, in all deceivableness of unrighteousness. Thus, as the apostles wrought miracles to confirm the gospel they preached, or rather, as the Lord wrought with them and confirmed the word with signs following, so Satan would work with Antichrist, endorsing his pretensions with false miracles designed to overthrow the gospel. Bishop John Jewell of Salisbury wrote in the 16th century, quote, of the first sort of false miracles, we have seen an infinite number in the days of our fathers and in the kingdom of Antichrist. Then was there an appearance of spirits and visions of angels. Our Lady came swimming down from heaven. Poor souls came creeping and crying out of purgatory and jetted abroad and kept stations, casting flakes of fire and beset highways, and bemoaned their cases, and pains and torments were so bitter. Quote, they sought for help and cried for good prayers. They cried for dirges. They cried for masses of requiem, for masses of scala sali, for trentals of masses. Hereof grew post-sale of pardons, and whereof grew the provinces of purgatory, the most gainful country that ever was under the city of Rome. Quote, but these miracles were no miracles at all. They were devised by subtle varlets and lazy lordanes for a purpose to get money. Oftentimes the spirit has been taken and laid in the stocks. The angel has been stripped. The good lady has been caught. The conveyance of the miracle has appeared. The engines and the slights and the cause and the manner of the working have been confessed. Quote, in those days, idols could go on foot. Roods could speak. Bells could ring alone. Images could come down and light their own candles. Dead stocks could sweat and bestir themselves. They could turn their eyes. They could move their hands. They could open their mouths. They could set bones and knit sinews. They could heal the sick and raise up the dead. Quoting further, these miracles were conveyances and subtleties, and indeed no miracles at all. The trunks by which they spake, the strings and the wires with which they moved their faces and hands, all the rest of their treachery have been disclosed. These are the miracles of which Paul speaks. Miracles in sight, in appearance, but indeed no miracles at all. Quote, it was also arranged that the saints should not have power to work in all places. Some wrought at Canterbury, some at Walsingham, some at York, and some at Buxton. Some in one place, some in another. Some in the town, some in the fields. Even as Jeremiah said among the Jews, chapter 11, quote, according to the number of thy cities were thy gods, unquote. Hereof grew the pilgrimages and the worshiping of the images and kissing of relics. Hereof grew oblations and the enriching of abbeys, every man and his particular saint on whom he called. Every country was full of chapels, every chapel full of miracles, and every miracle full of lies. That's the Roman Catholic Church. That is the history, the undisputed the admitted history of the Roman Catholic Church. Is it not the fulfillment? All power and signs and lying wonders in a very cheapish, carnivalish-like imitation of the true miracles conducted by the apostles. It's the Roman Catholic Church. There's no other candidate. God does not deal treacherously with his people. He has made a laughingstock of Antichrist. No one should be confused, and especially not those who call themselves Protestants. We'll make a mark here on page 112. We'll return to the text next Sunday on the broadcast. Thanks for listening. Now we'll stay tuned after a brief break for hopefully an hour of fruitful discussion about this book, Romanism and the Reformation, by Henry Grattan Guinness. Get a copy. Read it for yourself. Own the material of this book. Don't just listen to me. See it for yourself. Keep a copy of this. Refer to it often. Share it with friends. Help us to restore Protestantism in this country. Now, I will remind the listeners that I have a program that runs Monday through Friday. It's called Inquisition Update. It's heard Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. Central Time on FirstAmendmentRadio.com. So go to www.FirstAmendmentRadio.com, 10 a.m. Central, and listen to Inquisition Update as we restore Protestant knowledge, Protestant history, and a true understanding of the prophecies of God and the meaning of the scriptures that have been perverted. And thanks for listening. I'll see you next Sunday.